Hello friends, I'm Paul Shin from the YouTube channel that's making Model A's cool again. Today we're in Sutter Creek, California, a beautiful gold rush town. We're touring with the Modesto Area A's and we're at the Kyoto Inn. Let's check it out.
So, I think we'll get a good night's sleep.
What are you doing eating dinner in the bedroom, Tina?
Well, it seems like we can't get the other TV to work right.
Wait a minute. Well, oh, yeah. Good morning. It is another beautiful day here in California's gold country. Today, we're going somewhere very historic and very cool. We're going to Knight's Foundry.
Ready.
Wade Worsham, you are here at Knight's Foundry. Can you tell
Yes.
us a little bit about this before we start the tour, what we're going to see?
Well, we're going to see a cast iron foundry that was established in 1873. It was established to build a high pressure water motor. Sam Knight had to do all the prototype work and the development work. First, he submitted his documentation in 1874, November of 1874, and got it issued in January 1875. And that then replaced compressors throughout the gold country because there was high pressure water everywhere.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
And so we have the machinery that was used to do the prototype work. We have the casting facility. We have the we've got the pattern shop where they made the patterns that were going to be used to make the actual molds. And we'll turn on a few things.
Oh man, that's cool. We're gonna have a good time.
We're gonna go into this door here and it's called the office and bar. The bar, by the way, is not for drinking. The guy that did the books here also held court here. He was the local justice of the peace. So here's the water motor that powered this facility. Somebody asked, was this place run by steam? Yes, everything was run by steam until this water motor was invented. This is the first time they could replace steam. This gave, this could run somewhere around 150 horsepower. This powered the entire facility. So if you look back around, you see lots of belts and pulleys. We're gonna turn them on when we come back in, but most of the machines in this place were run with this one water motor all at the same time. At the time, this is 1870s, the gold mines would require about $2 worth of wood to process 1 ton of ore. 1 ton of ore was typically getting 1 ounce of gold. 1 ounce of gold at that time was $20. So you're getting $20 and spending $2 for the wood. And now you got to pay everybody and all the miners and processors and all the other stuff. And so when you put this water motor in, all of a sudden it cost almost zero to process. The water was nearly free and they turned around and ran it in a canal down to Ione and used it for agricultural purposes. And so didn't even lose the water. So it was a game changer in the whole area. It was the beginning of industrialization around here. Knight did hydroelectric power also, but he continued to support the mines, and so gold mining was really what this place was all focused on, and anything they needed in a gold mine. We're going to move into the foundry. So the first thing that we have to do when we go to build a part, and you can see a whole series of parts here. These are parts that we've poured here. We have, just to look at the physical space here, we've got a cupola furnaces over there, those tall things that go through the roof. And we've actually poured iron a half a dozen times. Mostly we pour it for some museums so that are restoring locomotives. We've poured a couple of times for the Northern Nevada Railway Museum in Ely, Nevada. And we also just did some brakes. That was fire grates for them, some 20 different, two different types of fire grates. And we built the patterns for them. And you know, here's a portion of a pattern made out of wood. We also just did some in January for Niles Canyon Railway Museum over in Sunol, Fremont area. We did brake shoes for them and some other things. These are this is actually a mold right here, the two halves of the mold. So this is the guy that you use to make the mold. It's got a top and bottom, and so what you're doing is you're taking part of it and starting off on a board, and you're putting a section of that's flat like this down against the board, and then you're going to take the sand and pack the sand in there. And when you take that guy and flip it over, it looks like this. You've got the patterns sitting in there, and the sand is nice and flat. You're going to put the other half onto that guy and put the rest of the patterns in there and pack sand on the back of that. And so then by the time you finish that effort, you'll take it apart again. This got a little parting powder on here so that the sand won't stick to the sand. Then you pick out these pieces and we'll put a hole through this mark right here, and that, and you make a little connection in here. And so the metal will go down that hole and into these cavities and fill everything out and create the parts. When you pull something out, it's going to look like this. The hole that the metal went down, called the sprue. This little tool creates, you know, the little tool here creates this well. And then right at there, at that point, you've got a gate so that you don't have to cut a bunch of metal to separate the part that you're really interested in having. And then you do some cleanup work, because there's a little bit of flash around the edges, and sometimes something doesn't come out totally clean. So how does the sand work? The sand is made up of three ingredients. You've got pure sand right there, a little bentonite clay. That sand is silica sand. It's very fine. It's mined over in Ione. And so there'd been a local source here for forever. You mix those two things together and it doesn't actually do much. And so there's the third ingredient, and the third ingredient is water. And this is to make what we call green sand. And so that third ingredient, when you add water and you mix it up, you can take it and squeeze it. This, by the way, has too much water. And it breaks in two. And that is what this sand, why the sand sticks together in here. Too much water because it's sticking to my hand. And so there's a little fine mixing. We do the mixing in that muller right there. That allows us to not use a shovel. I've done this with a shovel in a wheelbarrow. And we have our little water cans over there. They're green water cans, of course, because it's green sand. Yeah, it doesn't look green. There's a fourth ingredient that we use when we're doing iron, and that's sea coal. And what it does is it vaporizes when the hot iron hits it and makes a little better surface finish. It doesn't do anything for us when we're doing aluminum, not hot enough temperature. The aluminum melts at 1150. We bring it up to about 1300 to actually do a pour. But iron melts at 2250, and you're going to have me recorded, and so now you can check my accuracy, huh? At any rate, it around 2250, and but we bring it up to about 2800 degrees so that you have enough time to actually do the pour. But at any rate, you clean it up a little bit, and then you can reuse it. Mostly you have to worry about cleaning it up for the surfaces, because otherwise you'll get junk and you'll get a bad surface finish. But once you get back a little bit, it's not so important. With the sea coal in it, when we're doing iron, and that all has, because we did an iron pour, so almost all of our sand right now has got sea coal in it. But that is vaporizing, and so that starts to get used up over time. So you may have to do a new mix every so often, add some ingredients back in, take some out and put new sand in. But yeah, you can reuse it, and we do that routinely many times. So they'll heat that up until the iron gets to a certain level inside, and then they can tap the furnace. They'll use one of these harpoons to actually punch a hole in the breast, let the metal come pouring out. That lets the metal come out, then you put that plug back in, and you have to do that again and again. And you're using a small ladle like this. You got to run over, you got to pour, and they actually left some iron in there, so that's going to be an interesting challenge. Let's go take a look at some other stuff, and we'll go to the machine shop, and we're going to get out this door here. I'm just going to make sure I don't have anything that's going to become a problem. Okay. To get it to move, I bring this guy over this way. And now the lathe is running. And so I can start working on that. One of our guys actually cuts parts in here and uses this all the time. And so still works today. Notice the emergency off button. Yeah, people didn't get hurt because they paid attention and they didn't get in the works. It doesn't immediately stop. So, but that is the same basic principle that everything else, all the other machines run by that same principle. An idle roller, so when we turn on the works up above, no machine is going to turn on. They're all waiting for you to move the belt. Both of these lathes were built here. And as were all those machines down there and that planer. And we're going to go over by that planer right now. This planer was built here. It has a 12-foot stroke. And it can make flat surfaces or it can make grooves. It was built here in 1882, and one of the interesting things is up above, you see that water motor? That water motor was added to power this planer. So you can see belts going up and down. Shaft is rolling right above your head. It's got power going to all these guys. Way back over there, they're bringing power back up this way. So, remember the mechanism, I gotta move a belt. The belt is up over there. And so, I'm gonna move that belt, and this guy will get going. Right over here is the business end. And it's actually cutting metal there, making a nice little chip. This was built in 1902. And so, this is a little bit of mechanical automation here. A shaper is very much like the planer. It does flat surfaces and it does grooves. And for instance, you would put a groove on a shaft and you put a groove on a gear, and that's called a keyway. And then you put a square key in there and it'll keep that from moving on the shaft. And so you could put those grooves in, or you could just make a flat surface like this is doing here. So these two points basically define the stroke, how far it's going to go. But they do that by hitting this guy here. When they hit that guy, it changes which belt is on the center pulley. The center pulley is the drive pulley. The two outer pulleys are both idle pulleys. They don't do anything. So just like the machine wasn't running on the idle pulley up there, now it's on the drive pulley, the machine is running. So the center one is the drive one. Now, one belt is going forward, and it goes a lot slower because it has a much smaller belt up above. The backwards one goes a lot faster, but it also has a twist in here which makes it go the other direction. So it goes back faster because there's no load. It goes slower going forward because it's got more work to do. The other thing that goes on is when it hits the back, this guy makes a little turn here, which is basically bringing this chuck forward just a little bit, which is adjustable. It can be set to whatever you want it to do. Up and down, you have to turn this crank, but this sideways motion doing a flat surface is basically automatic. So, mechanical automation version from 1902.
So I've lived in the gold country off and on most of my life, and I've been all around the gold country and seen a lot of gold mining history and a lot of history about the towns around where I live. But I've never been here before. This is amazing. Knight Foundry in Sutter Creek. It's really historic. It's really cool. And what I really like is it smells like manly men, like metal, big fire and stuff. Friends, we just had dinner in Volcano, California. You probably never heard of it. It's a really, really small town, one of those you blink, you miss it kind of things. In the middle of Volcano, gold country is this amazing diamond. This is called the Union Inn.
Volcano Union Inn.
This is Chef Eric. This was absolutely amazing. So Tina and I shared, we both got different dishes and then shared them between us. So I'd ordered the fried chicken and Tina ordered the grilled salmon.
Yes.
Knocked it out of the park. I'm not joking. I'm dead serious. Okay, I'm not just blowing smoke.
Okay.
That's the best fried chicken I've had in my life.
Oh, thank you.
Seriously, yeah. Chef Ramsey would not call you a donkey. I'm telling you.
I hope
that
not.
Was amazing.
Well,
Chef Eric, thank you.
Thank you so much.
So much. The Union Inn, Volcano, California. Check it out. I'll put a thing right down here.
Yes.
Here's where to get a hold of them, right here.
There you go.
Thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you so
buddy.
Much.
Man, this is great. Thanks.
Yeah.
Good morning. It is day three of our tour with the Modesto Area A's. Today we are in Jackson, California. This is the Kennedy Gold Mine. There were two mines in Jackson, the Kennedy and the Argonaut. The Argonaut's the one that made all the press. There were some people that unfortunately lost their lives doing that job. Kennedy Mine had a little bit better track record. So today we're going to tour the mine and figure out what it is that makes this mine special.
This mine employed on average of about 200 people. They ran two shifts a day. About 60 actually in the mine, and then everybody else is working on the surface doing something, keeping the equipment going and all that. The third shift was bailing water out of the mine. This mine is 5,912 feet deep. It's well over a mile down. It was the deepest mine in North America when it shut down. It had the tallest headframe in North America, 125 feet tall. The mother lode is a seam of quartz, a large seam of quartz. I'll talk later about how it got there, but it lays north-south, pretty much, and it's diving 60 degrees down towards the east. So they came over here and started digging in 1900, roughly, and about 3,000 feet down, they intercepted their other workings. Okay, come on over here, we'll go through the headframe. This steel headframe was put up in 1928 after the fire. They bring this down to the top is here at the level, right? And nine guys climb down in that thing on a ladder, and then they put boards on the top, and they add about another 8 or 10 on top. Just hanging onto those rails, and down you go, 25 miles an hour, zee-ha. Oh. And there's a guy in the back just manually controlling the stopping and starting of this thing. You don't punch floor 17 and have it stop there, you know, like an elevator. It's all manual. So they use bell signals that tell them where they want to stop and where they want to get off and go to work. And that's how it goes. There's a ton of ore in there, you can do it. Getting it started is the hard part. Once it starts, it goes pretty easy. Must be a rock on it or something. There you go. Moving a ton.
One more set of muscles.
Okay, so this haul is about a ton of ore. And you'll see in the movie, these guys are just dumping this thing, right? But the pivot point's right about here. It's not that bad. Probably maybe 200 pounds a lift to do it. So they got one guy on each side lifting 100 pounds. Do that all day. See how it feels. Shovel this thing in by hand all day. The average miner lasted about 6 weeks. It's just an awful job. You're down in the hole. It's almost 90 degrees down there. 100% humidity. Water dripping on you. Rocks falling on you. We had 37 men come to work in this mine one morning and not go home that night because they died.
Oh my word.
37 men. So that, well, once every 2 years we lost one, you know. The Argonaut over there lost 47 at one shot. We'll talk about that later. I'll just really quickly talk about the Crusher. It's just a big paddle banging the rock, breaking it down to where it'll fit into the stamps. I'd like to talk about this though, because if you go back in those days, you see a lot of equipment that looks like this. You got these big wheels on them. Any idea why that's there?
Or weight? Inertia?
It's inertia. That's exactly what it is. You don't have a lot of horsepower with this thing. You know, these early days equipment, old steam engine or something to wind it up. But once you get it wound up with all this big weight and the inertia of it, it'll just keep breaking rock all day long. So, but look at the pressure this thing must have been under. Look at the size of the nuts that are holding this thing together.
Oh my word.
Gosh. Could you even carry the wrench that turns that thing, you know? This is the retort room. This is where you take the gold from the stamp mill. It comes up here as this mercury gold amalgam. And they put it into this furnace over here, where they heat it to about 700 degrees, and that drives off the mercury. It's in a closed system. You don't want to breathe mercury vapor. It's very bad for you. You heard of the Mad Hatter. That's why, because they were using mercury to clean furs back in there. And the drive makes you go crazy. Mercury vapor is really bad, but the hard mercury is not that bad. Okay, so anyway, you gather it back up after you're done with it in these lead vessels here, and it goes back down to the stamp mill and gets reused. Mercury was very expensive. It was almost as much as gold. So, all right. That gives you what's called gold sponge when you're done with it. It's the mercury gold amalgam with the mercury driven off. And this is what it looks like.
Gold sponge?
Gold sponge. Looks like a sponge.
Oh, yeah, it does.
With the mercury driven out. This stuff then goes into this furnace, and you heat it up to about 2,000 degrees, and that melts it. And then it goes into this mold. And then they take it over to the scale and weigh it. And as I said, as we figured it, that $17,000 bar weighs about 60 pounds. It's nice, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Put you up for the night there?
Yeah.
You got to listen to the stamp mill hammering away all night, though.
I need earplugs big time.
Yeah, I don't know how it would be with the stamp mill, but that had to be making a racket.
Yeah.
That takes care of day three of this 3-day tour with the Modesto Area A's. This is exactly why you join a Model A club, because you get to go out and do things as a group that as an individual you'd probably never get to do or never get to see. So anyway, check out the Model A club nearest you. Go to the Model A Ford Club of America website, click on the big map, you can click on a state, find a club that's somewhere near you. Thank you so much for watching this video. I can't wait to see you on the next one. Drive it like you know how to fix it. Thank you.